Und herzlich willkommen, Lisbeth Fjären. She is the one who is speaking English. That's why I introduce her in English now too. She is an associate professor in risk management and societal safety at the University of Stavanger. She completed her PhD in 2020 on risk perception issues and uncertainty-based risk perspectives. She is currently involved in the new established bachelor program in urban planning and social safety at the University of Stavanger. And her research interests include risk perception and risk communication, in particular related to climate change. And the title of her presentation is Conditions for Critical Trust. Welcome, the stage is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Eva, for the introduction. And thank you for the Bundesinstitut für Risikobewertung. I hope I said it correctly. I chose Spanish and French at schools. And today I'm a bit sorry that I didn't choose German. So I'm sorry for having to do this in English, but I think Norwegian would be even worse. Okay, so the title for my presentation is Conditions for Critical Trust. So in a crisis or in a situation where we do not have a lot of knowledge, relevant experience, and where uncertainties are high, maybe we also are under time pressure, then we may use our trust as a cue or as a shortcut for making a decision or guiding our behavior. So it's, even though the topic of the talk today is trust, it's very important to note that in this relation, other factors also are important. So our values, our knowledge, our feelings, our culture, our social group memberships are also factors influencing this. But today, we're going to talk about trust, so this is what I'll focus on. So since I am an academic, I have now provided you with some definitions. I will not read through them. My point is that there are many definitions, but they have some common aspects. You see them in the blue circles here. So talking about trust in a way or another presupposes a risk. So it's about something we don't know, something in the future, about uncertainties. It also involves making yourself vulnerable in a relationship or to another person, a system, or an institution. And it's also associated with some beliefs or expectations about the will or attention or behavior of this institution or entity in which you have placed your trust. So when talking about trust, it's important to specify who we are talking about and in relation to what. So since I am from Norway, I will be talking about trust of the Norwegian public in their institutions, and I will first and foremost be relating this to the COVID pandemic. We'll also take a look at the Norwegian trust over time, not just relating to the pandemic. So why should you be interested in hearing about what we Norwegians up in our little country up north do and think? I believe it could be interesting because we are often characterized as a high trust society, or the high trust society. But as you also see here in blue, you see that many other countries also has high levels of trust. So the public has high trust in their institutions. So I believe it's also relevant for you. And you see that Germany is also quite blue here. Also, such trust, institutional trust, has been related to a set of tendencies or behaviors, as you see here on the top. So it has been linked to acceptance and compliance with authority, advice, and rules and policies, effective functioning of societal processes, lower risk perception, and to an increased responsiveness in crisis situations like the pandemic. So, high trust in institutions has been linked or has been emphasized in explaining how the Norwegian society responded during the crisis, the pandemic. So you see some statements here, and you see that this understanding, it dominates in, so linking trust to an increased responsiveness, has been identified by many in scientific work, in articles, in publications, by statements of public officials, by politicians, in the media, and it's also very much part of the national narrative in a way. So you see here on the top, you see Erna Solberg. So it was Norwegian Prime Minister at the point of time, when in her speech before the lockdown of the Norwegian society, she said this. She said, "It is about trust. What now is happening with the support of the opposition is only possible because so many of us trust that the authorities want what is best for us." So it's this trust that will carry us through the crisis. So you also see here that there is a picture of a German professor. It is not a mistake. It's just to show and to illustrate that these statements are not unique to the Norwegian context. We also find it in other parts of the world and in other countries. So I put those examples in there because they all reflect some ideas that I believe is dominating in much research and in much practice of risk managing institutions and of governments. Namely, the fact that trust is often approached as an ideal state of affairs, as an ideal situation, something that we strive for. So in a way, the more, the higher trust, the better. And very often this appears to go hand in hand with an understanding that distrust is something negative, something that should be prevented or reduced in different ways. So in parallel, there exists an understanding, although not shared by all researchers, but there exists an understanding that trust is on decline, or that it has decreased the last decades. So it has been described as that we are part of something called, or described as a post-trust society, or an era of distrust. And that trust is something that we must build, something that has to be rebuilt, and that this takes time. Because trust is fragile and it's unstable. So it takes very long to build trust, but that it can easily be destroyed. So trust, in a way, is something that should be handled with care. So what I will do now in the following is that I will present some data concerning Norwegian trust in institutions over different periods of time. And I will do this to highlight some developments made in research. And I will also do this to highlight the relevance or importance of discussing some of the ideas or assumptions that I believe dominate the way trust is approached in much practice and in research. So first, I will present some data from some national weekly surveys conducted on behalf of the Norwegian Directorate of Health over a 2-year period of time, so during the pandemic, or actually before the pandemic started, before any measures were implemented, and towards the end, or what many saw as the end, where the pandemic went into a new phase in a way, where things became more normalized. So what you will see now in the following is are some graphs and some numbers, and I do not have time to go through all these. I will go through what is most important for the presentation, but I have provided some reference that you can look up later if you're interested, or if it goes too quick, or you can ask me if we have time. So when asked the question, to what extent do you have trust in the authorities' management of the coronavirus? The answers gave away this picture, or this line you see here. So what we see is that trust during the pandemic was high, but that it fluctuated. So it fell and it increased, it fell and it increased. So we see especially in the beginning, we see that it drops markedly. So from week 6 to 10, we see that there is a drop. So at this point of time, we could read about the virus, hear about the virus in different parts of the world, of it spreading, of its consequences. But at home, we could continue as before. So we could go to the Alps on winter holiday. We could come home, at least in my region, with no infection control measures. And we could go to work. So there was, in a way, a mismatch between what happened out there in the world and what happened at home. So also, I cannot go through all the drops here, but we see that towards the end of 2021 and the turning of the year, 21-22, trust also drops. So at this point of time, infection rates again increase, and new measures are implemented to delay the spread of the Omicron variant of the virus. What we also see is that these drops, they coincide with an increase in worry. So this is not straightforward, doesn't happen all the time, but it's a tendency, it's a trend that when trust drops, also worry seems to increase. But what we see is that these drops or increases, they are also of a short-term character. So as you see here, you see that in week 11, when measures were implemented and when the Norwegian society went into lockdown, we see that trust increases quickly and significantly. So, another slide to illustrate that once measures were implemented, we complied. And we complied throughout the pandemic. But as you see here with the green line, we see that this did not imply that we always agreed. So we actually disagreed, or sometimes we disagreed more than others, but we did not agree with the measures all the time. We did not always believe that these were the best ones, the best or the most correct strategies, but we complied. I will come back to this later. But all in all, taken together, these data that I presented, it shows that during the pandemic, trust fell. But it fell, this trend here is very weak, only slightly. But looking at this line here, you could easily reach a conclusion that trust during the pandemic decreased. However, zooming out a bit, the picture becomes a bit different. So if we take a look at these data here, and I'm sorry for I see that some of the text is in Norwegian, but I'll translate. So if we first take a look at these data from OECD, we see that trust, again, is quite high. We see that from 2006 to 2021, that trust has increased from 68 to 77%. And we see that there has been an increase in trust during the pandemic. We see that trust is highest in 2020, and we see this for all the countries, not only for Norway. The data from the trust barometer, Norwegian data here, shows the same tendency. It shows that trust during the pandemic has increased. But what is also important to note here is that the data from 2020, where you see that trust levels are high, these are collected at the point of time where measures have been implemented. So they do not reflect or cover the same fall as we saw in the previous data. So this increase in trust during the pandemic is not unique to the Norwegian context. It's been found in many other countries, especially during the first wave of the pandemic. And it has been described as something called the rally around the flag effect, saying that when societies are hit by a crisis, people tend to become more favorable toward their political leaders and trust in their government often increases. But also, this increase in trust and in support is rarely long-term. And the data shows the same. So these data from the Norwegian Trust Barometer shows that in 2022, Norwegian trust levels in a way bounced back. So it bounced back to what these researchers call the normal level, or back to where it was before the pandemic. In fact, slightly higher, but almost the same. So my point here is that different data, they tell different stories, or different parts of the story. So where previous data have told stories that we are living in societies characterized by distrust, and that trust is on the decline, and that trust is fragile and unstable, the data I just presented tell somewhat a different story. So it shows that trust is high, that it fluctuates, it varies over time, it increases and it decreases, but that these changes appear to be of a more short-term character. So what I would like to argue that based on these data, trust in fact appears to be quite strong, not fragile, appears to be quite elastic. And if anything, I would say also that the data, if we look at the data, these data, the data that zooms out, these data, trust, in fact, is increasing over time, in the Norwegian society at least. So the data I presented cannot be seen as evidence of anything, but as indicating or pointing in a certain direction. In a direction similar to some statements or research findings of other researchers before me. And here you see some examples. I haven't got time to go through them. But what I would say that these statements here, they also point at the relevance or importance of discussing some of the ideas surrounding the trust concept. And another lesson or story learned by the data, or the way risks were communicated during the pandemic, at least in Norway, is that despite Norwegian trust is and was high, it was not blind. So as we saw, you can see it here on the top, it looks very small actually, but the green line, if you remember it, showed that despite us complying, we did not always agree with the measures that were implemented. Nor did we believe that the Norwegian society was sufficiently prepared for a pandemic or handled it perfectly at all points of time. But still we trust and still we complied. And also, the risk communication during the crisis in Norway was characterized by an openness, by a transparency. So experts openly disagreed. Debates were public and open. Public officials admitted not knowing. They admitted making misjudgments and errors sometimes. Also, a commission was established during the COVID pandemic, investigating the authorities' handling of the crisis and communicated its findings during the pandemic. Also, we got information from different sources, different channels, and sometimes information was conflicting. But we still trusted and complied. And I think that this concept here, critical trust, excellently describes this way of trusting, of relating to information from governments and institutions. It says that we can trust, but be critical and skeptical at the same time. And here I would like to pose a question or present an idea that I made as part of a paper I wrote in my PhD. And it is this. May it be that the accounts of us being part of a distrust society or declining trust, may it be that this is just an expression of some responses made by a critically trusting public. So reflection of some healthy skepticism or healthy precaution, of a more informed and knowledgeable and reflexive public. Maybe. I argue that appreciating and acknowledging this, that trust is nuanced, that what we often just call public trust or public distrust, it is more than just that. So we can trust and be skeptical at the same time, and that this skepticism, in a way, can be seen as something healthy or as a resource. Maybe something that we should want more of. So in fact, I argue that creating conditions for such critical trust can help build more resilient communities in times of crisis like the pandemic. But not only relating to pandemics or more acute risk, also risks that are less visible, where consequences are less visible, at least to some, like, for instance, climate change risks. So I believe, and I also believe research has indicated that high or full trust in such a situation, in fact, can act to hinder or inhibit us taking action and making long-term changes. Because often high trust is associated with a lower risk perception or an underestimation of consequences and losses. Also, it has been shown that critically trusting citizens are more engaged, more involved in participation and take part in debates to a larger extent than trusting ones. And we know that if we have been informed and if we have been involved in these processes where risks are assessed or decisions are made, we may accept decisions despite not always agreeing with these. And I argue that this requires not only focusing on public trust in institutions and in increasing this, but in placing increased trust in the public, that authorities and institutions also place more trust in their public, in their knowledge and in their capabilities of handling uncertainties and conflicting information and in making more risk-informed decisions. And I believe that important steps are and have been taken in this direction. So, for instance, we have seen it in the way that risks and uncertainties were communicated during the pandemic. Also, different institutions have taken different initiatives in this direction, for instance, by adopting broader definitions and conceptualizations of risk, or institutions have made it or opened up and made transparent scientific assessment and decision-making process, and in a larger extent inviting stakeholders and public to take part in these in different ways. And I believe that these are all examples of attempts at making the public a larger part of the story and the direction that we should go. And then thank you. Thank you for listening to me.